my friends, today, as you probably well know, is the fifth day of Christmas. What does this mean for us here in the West? Well, for most of us, it means that we might be back at work. It means that there are probably very few, if any, presents under the tree. It means that radio stations no longer play Christmas music. It means that many in the West have put away their decorations, the lights, trees have been thrown out or boxed up. It means that we're all tired of eating leftovers. It means grocery stores have restocked, and the hustle and bustle of Christmas is gone. Life for many of us is slower, or at least more normal. Maybe if we did not have the space in our lives to observe a holy Advent the way we wanted, we can pause for a moment here on the fifth day of Christmas and wonder about Christ coming into the world. Doing it on the fifth day of Christmas does not lessen this act. It does not make us bad Episcopalians. In fact, I would venture to say that it makes us the best Episcopalians. Pondering the meaning of Christ coming into the world during the Christmas season is good, is necessary, is life-giving. And today, our gospel gives us a starting point. It is fitting that as we approach a new calendar year, our reading begins with creation. We all know this line, in the beginning, and you can believe that all of the Jewish world at that time knew it when it was written and when it was read. In the beginning is Genesis 1, but this is not Genesis. This is not the Old Testament. This is the Gospel of John, and if you have read any of the Gospel of John, you know that John is very skilled at using words phrases to cause people to give pause, to stop in their tracks. In typical abstractness, John writes, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Our English language does us no justice in trying to help us understand what John is getting at. There's been much scholarly discussion over what is being said here. In Hebrew, the word is Sophia, wisdom. In the beginning was wisdom, and wisdom was with God, and wisdom was God. This makes it a little more clear. In the Greek, the word is logos, roughly meaning divine knowledge. It's sort of the same thing. John has caused people to pause. Their ears have perked up when they hear or have read, in the beginning was the Word. It's not in the beginning God. This in the beginning has changed and caused people to be curious. Probably some are upset, others perplexed. It's almost as if we changed the liturgical color of Advent from blue to orange. Didn't tell anyone. Some of you would walk in and give pause. What's going on here? What's this about? In the beginning was the Word has redefined creation. Creation is now about the wisdom, the knowledge of God, setting all things into being. We read on the eve of this new year that John has shifted the understanding of creation. Creation is no longer about the birds of the air or the fish of the sea. Creation is now about believing and trusting in the divine knowledge of God. Creation is about becoming children of God. This is why God created. This is our lens. John takes this another step further. And the Word, the wisdom, the divine truth this time, a Christmas creation story. What is to be gained in considering that the first creation reminds us that all things were made with God's divine truth, and without this truth, there would be nothing? Here our lives, or how are our lives different if we understand the second creation story, the Christmas creation story, is about this divine truth bearing flesh and living in the world to show us how to live a life of light and love. Pausing here today, let us wonder how our lives change in thinking about Christ coming into our world some 2,000 years ago and bringing with him all knowledge and power and understanding, living a life John tells us that we have all received grace upon grace in Christ's coming. What does grace upon grace look like? If we keep reading about Christ's life in John's Gospel, we see sharp images of what this grace can be. For John, receiving this grace upon grace means being above instead of below, being full of light, not darkness. Embracing the spirit of who we are and not our flesh. Being in this world, but not of this world. Being children of God instead of children of the devil. For John, it is living in a world that God loved so much that he gave his only son to. But one that will hate his son and hate those who come to believe in him. John's gospel soars with language of love and bites with harsh words of opposition. These contrasts describe John's world, and it does not seem too far off from our world. John lived in a world of polarizing light versus dark, spirit versus flesh, people of love versus love. Many would say we live in the same world. In John's gospel, Jesus' followers often have a hard time making sense of their world. For me, at least, I often struggle making sense of this world. I find myself asking, what makes people act this way? How did we get to this point? How can this decision or that idea be the best for all people? What is my role? Or what is the role of the church in our current situation? Where is my hope? Where is the love? Where is the divine truth? The divine truth is here in John's gospel. The divine truth is in the other gospels. It's in Paul's letters, and it's in the lives of many who came before us. Divine truth is also alive and well in us here in this space today. The divine truth was in the beginning. The divine truth was with God. It was God. The divine truth came into this world in flesh, born to a carpenter and a young teenage girl. This truth was wrapped in meager cloth. A new beginning, a new way of life, living as divine truth was established. This is the beginning of Christmas. On the fifth day of Christmas, as we look to the new year, how might we be about the work of Christmas? The work of remembering and living the divine truth as Christians during this season. How might this new year look and feel more divinely true? Howard Thurman, an African-American theologian, educator, and civil rights, explained it this way. When the song of the angels is stilled, when the star in the sky is gone, when kings and princes are home, the shepherds are back with their flocks, the work of Christmas begins. To find the lost, to heal the broken, to feed the hungry, to release the prisoner, to rebuild the nations, to bring peace